Hello, my name is Potro and welcome to Winning Chess the Easy Way. Today you would have a chance to sit down with one of the greatest women's world champion ever, Susan Polgar. She would take you through step by step of some of the things to do and not to do in chess. And today's topic is opening traps and pitfalls to avoid. Susan?
Thank you, Paul. Hi, welcome all to this segment of Winning Chess the Easy Way. Today we're going to look at some fun short games that are instructional at the same time. Generally speaking, when you follow the basic opening principles, you can avoid getting in trouble. Let me refresh what are these basic opening principles that you need to follow. The first thing you do when you start a game of chess, you put at least one of your center pawns to d4 or e4, or if you're black, d5 or e5 usually. If your opponent allows, to put both center d and e pawns in the center, even better. The next thing you do, you get usually your knight out first, then your bishop. The third thing you do, you try to castle, and then develop the rest of your pieces. There are also two things you need to remember to avoid. Do not bring your queen out early. That's the last piece you want to move. And another thing, do not move the same piece twice, until all your other pieces moved at least once. Of course, you have to understand that there can be and are exceptions to that. For example, if your opponent attacks one of your pieces, of course, you're not gonna just continue developing and leave your attacked piece hanging, right? So therefore, you have to adjust your plans according to your opponent's moves. In these short games that we're going to see today, one side will set up traps. At times, they are all sound moves and the trap is legitimate and the other side needs to watch out not to fall in it. Now, today we'll see cases only when the other side does fall in the traps, so that's what this DVD is about. And then we'll learn how to avoid them, how not to fall into the trap. However, I have to tell you that in many of the games, one side in a way gambles, and that's something I not recommend, even though if you're lucky, you may win a quick game, a short game. That's nice. However, if the opponent plays the correct way, you have worsened your position. So therefore, I would like you to watch these games from the sense how not to fall into traps, not necessarily copying to try to win in 8 or 10 or 15 moves. Now, sit back, relax, and enjoy. Have fun. Okay, we are ready for our first game.
White starts with e4.
This is one of the most standard opening moves, occupying the center and opening up the diagonal of the bishop.
And black responds with e5.
Black is being a copycat, doing the same thing, occupying the center and opening up the road of the bishop.
And now white brings the queen out immediately to h5.
That's the first mistake of several. It's better to get the knight out first, the bishop out, and put the king into safety before we get the queen out. The only good thing about getting the queen out early is to attack the pawn in the center.
And black responds with knight to c6.
Black noticed the threat, protected the pawn, and therefore the queen is silly out there.
And white plays bishop to c4.
Well, this is the basic moves of the so-called scholar's mate. And now, if black is careless, doesn't notice what white wants to do, which is to checkmate with the queen, then black will be sorry. One common mistake that black does here comes here with the knight to attack the queen, thinking that the queen needs to move away. Yes, the queen will move away, giving checkmate, still nothing changed. So that's certainly not the right move.
And black defends the checkmate threat with g6.
Now, black would have several ways to defend the checkmate threat, but the best is what black played in the game, blocking the threat with g6. Protecting the f7 square with the queen is possible, but less good because it also gets out the queen prematurely and stands in a way the other minor pieces way, here in the bishop's way, and here takes away the square from the knight. So the best answer is g6, not only protecting against the checkmate, but also counterattacking right away the queen.
And white retreats the queen to f3.
White doesn't give up, wants to give checkmate again, this time from the f-file.
And black plays knight to f6.
Again, the best way to defend against it. If black was not careful, again, checkmate would come. So this is a good way to protect against it. Of course, the black queen is protecting the knight.
And now white moves the queen for the third time to b3.
Well, this is getting too much already. So many queen moves, that's already a serious problem. White is persistent in attacking the pawn on f7. Wants to take it with the bishop, but neglects developing the pieces. Again, instead of the queen move, white should get the knight out, getting ready to castle. Or maybe play c3, preventing the knight from coming to d4.
And now black plays knight to d4.
Well, this is an interesting moment. Black could simply protect the pawn by moving the queen out to e7 and have a normal game. However, because white already broke so many rules by getting the queen out early, by moving the same piece more than once, black can punish white. And even though it's by moving a same piece a second time, but it's only after white broke the rules.
White plays queen to d3.
Queen d3 moves away from the attack of the knight and protects the pawn on e4. However, you may ask, who stopped white from capturing the pawn on f7? Let's see what happens now. The black king gets out to e7. And now the problem is that the queen cannot hold on to protecting the bishop. If the queen moves away, the bishop will be lost. And if the queen holds on to the bishop for now, then think for a moment, what would you do? And the correct answer is moving the pawn up, chasing the queen away. And then, after the queen even gives a check, we get the bishop. So here, black lost the right to castle, that's true, but gained the bishop, which is a serious advantage and well worth it, giving up the right to castle in this case. Let's go back to our position after the queen moved to d3.
Black plays d5.
Well, this is a very energetic move, and we'll see in a moment why it's good. Black could have continued the game by developing bishop to g7, let's say, and to castle and so on, but this is a lot better.
White plays e, takes d5.
White took the pawn. Let's see what would happen if white plays differently and takes the pawn with the bishop. Similar, but first they trade the knight for the bishop, and then black does the same thing as in the game, getting the bishop out, making a skewer, chasing the queen away, and once the queen moves, then the knight can take the pawn, checking the king and attacking the rook, winning material. The best that white could have done instead of taking the pawn on d5 was to move the bishop away to b3, which is a sad story, I have to agree, because white loses the pawn on e4 next, but it's yet better than to lose a piece or a rook. Let's continue after pawn takes pawn.
Black plays bishop to f5.
And this was the whole idea of black's play in the last couple of moves. Now the queen is under attack.
Queen to g3.
The queen moves away. That's still better than moving it, let's say, to e3, because white would be under a family fork, check, queen attack, and rook attack all at once. Queen g3.
Knight takes c2, check.
And knight takes pawn, checking the king and attacking the rook. That's a fork.
White played king to f1.
Now, besides all the material losses that white has to face, also lost the right to castle.
And black developed the bishop to d6.
That's a very fine move. Black has the time to protect the pawn. could have taken the rook right away, but would have lost this pawn. And there is no need to give up on it, because the white rook is trapped anyway. It doesn't run away. And white resigned in this position. It's a lost position, white is losing the rook. What did we learn from this game? Like many people like to win quickly. It's nice, but usually it doesn't work. What did white do in this game? Got the queen out early and tried to checkmate very quickly with the scholar's mate. As we saw, if black knows just a little bit how to defend against it, white will get in serious trouble. So I definitely do not recommend try to win with the scholar's mate. Learn from this game, from the aspect how not to fall into it. What was white's problem? White made 5 moves with the queen. It's far too many instead of developing the pieces and putting the king into safety. So just follow the opening principles. Don't get the queen out. Okay, we're ready for our next game, game 2.
Once again, white developed with e4.
So far we're following the first game.
Black responds with e5. And now white played bishop to c4.
This is a much better move than getting the queen out, like in our previous game.
Black responds with d6.
This move is a little bit passive. It closes in this bishop. I would recommend rather developing this knight or the other one first.
And now white plays knight to f3.
That's a fine developing move, getting ready to castle.
And black played bishop to g4.
Even though this is a developing move and seemingly good one because makes a pin, right? The white knight is tied down now, cannot move because white would lose the queen. However, black neglects 2 things. One, that it doesn't develop the king's side, doesn't get ready to castle, which should be a priority in this case. The other one is that it puts the bishop on an unprotected square. Let's stop here for a moment and see what black should do instead. The most natural move, getting the knight out to f6, would be a mistake, an even bigger mistake than the bishop g4 move. Namely, because it allows the white knight to get to g5. This is an opening trap you should remember. Now the problem is that there is a threat on the f7 pawn, both from the bishop and the knight, and there is no good defense to it. Black is getting in trouble. Therefore, the better move is to develop the bishop first. In this case, this is an exception. Normally, I recommend developing the knight first. This is an exception when it's better to develop the bishop first. Bishop e7, now the knight g5 is not yet possible because the bishop would capture. And let's say after white castling, then already the knight can safely get out because now after knight g5, black is thought completely fine by castling and so defending the f7 pawn a second time. Let's go back to our game where black played bishop g4.
White plays knight to c3.
White proceeds with developing, controlling the center.
Black plays knight to c6.
That's a fine developing move too.
h3.
This is the critical moment of the game. The black bishop is under attack and needs to decide. It has 3 choices. It can go back, it can move, maintaining the pin, or capture the knight.
Now black